Welcome to WHBC TV. Merry Christmas to you and a blessed Happy New Year to you and yours. We're glad you've come to this broadcast this morning. It's a day the Lord has made. We'll rejoice and be glad in it. Oh, what a wonderful time we had in Africa. And it's such a great blessing to be back with you again after our 2 weeks vacation. And this morning, I'm going to be inviting you to come with me into the sanctuary as we go into worship so you can have a taste of what God is doing here at Wellman Heights Baptist Church before we go into the message. The message this morning is entitled, Expecting, from the Gospel of Luke chapter 2, verses 36 to 38. Why don't you get your Bible and come with me into the sanctuary as we go deep into the Word of God, and I will come back and pray with you so you can experience the amazing work of God that is doing here at Wellman Heights. Come with me.
Away from the noise, alone with you.
Wow. Oh. It's good to be back home again. Good morning, Wilma. Oh, you can do better than that. I haven't seen you in 2 weeks. You haven't seen me in 2 weeks. Good morning, Wilma.
Good morning.
Oh, we missed you. We missed you. Did you miss us too? You may not know this, but the Kinil and I were talking about this when he picked us up at the airport. It's a blessing for a pastor, or any pastor for that matter, to leave the church in the hands of godly, able men. Wouldn't you say? You're blessed, church, you're blessed. Unlike Moses, when he was going up onto the mountain to meet with God, he left Aaron in charge of the camp. Lord have mercy. When he came back, you heard, when the cat is away. These people were playing the olive tree, dancing naked in front of a golden calf. Assistant Pastor Heron leading the show. No. When we came back, I'm glad you went all bowing before a golden calf. You're blessed. And it's so good to be back. I can't wait to share what God has laid on my heart as we've been praying and fasting and seeking God's face for the new year. You're going to be hearing me share some things this morning that might not be your usual Christmas messages, but that's okay. It's still Christmas. I said it's still Christmas. Amen. How many of you are ready for the word? All right. My assignment this morning brings me to the Gospel of Luke chapter 2. Gospel of Luke chapter 2, and I'll be reading from verses 36 to 38 to your hearing. Verse 36. And there was a prophetess, Hannah, the daughter of Phinehas, of the tribe of Asher. And she was advanced in years and had lived with her husband 7 years. So she married, and 7 years her husband died. And then for the rest of her life, she was, verse 37, a widow. To the age of 84, she never left the temple, serving night and day with fastings and prayers. At that very moment, she came up and began giving thanks to God and continued to speak of Him, that is Jesus, to all those who are looking for the redemption of Jerusalem. The title of my message to you before you take your seat, the title of my message to you this morning is Expecting. Before you take your seat, greet someone next to you and ask them, expecting? Oh, some of you are getting nervous. I can tell some of you are already getting nervous. You may be seated. You don't even know what expecting is. You're already getting nervous. Praise God. I'm expecting. And looking at some of you, I can tell, looking at some of you, you look like you're expecting two. Somebody saw me this morning and said, Pastor, did you put on weight? I'm expecting. Christmas is a time of great expectations. I'm sure when you were a child, you remember when you couldn't wait for Christmas to come. Little children especially can't wait for Christmas to come. And you know why? There was a little boy who wanted a watch for Christmas. And he keeps bringing it up to his father's attention that he wanted a watch. You know how kids would nag you to death if they wanted something so badly? Are your kids like mine? Your kids are like mine. Okay, good. So this boy's father got tired of the boys nagging him for a wristwatch. And he says to his son, don't mention it again, or else you won't get. Comprehend? And the little boy, at the mealtime, the boy was asked to pray. So he bowed his head and said, I would like to quote a scripture before I pray. It's Mark, put it up. It's Mark chapter 13, verse 37. He said, I would like to read it before I pray. So he said, what I want to say, what I say to you, I say to everyone, watch. Come on now. Don't we all, like that little boy, expect to get a gift at Christmas? And sometimes we even give people hints of what we want them to get for us. And if they don't get it, don't leave me up here by myself. Oh, come on, you're looking at me. I know the Bible says it is better to give than to... Okay. You do the giving part. You go ahead and do the giving part. I would do the receiving. I like the giving part. Don't get me wrong. And I'm a giver, but I also like the receiving part too. Thank you. Christmas time is all about expectations. Even Walmart and Hallmark are already reporting whether or not your Christmas purchases have met their sales expectations. You listen to the report on 680 News when they give the business report. Oh, there's something about the joy of expecting. I'll never forget when we were expecting our first child, Adam. Excuse me, correction. Let me take that back. Let me rephrase that. I will never forget when she was expecting. I only helped in the expecting in a little small way. You know what I'm talking about? Okay. So, but she did all the expecting for 9 months. But I was so excited. You would have thought I'd won Lotto Max jackpot. Every time I met people, I'll say, did you hear we're expecting? I couldn't wait to let everyone know, even though I didn't even know what the child would look like. Would it be beautiful like
like the mother, or would he be ugly like her? I was going to say like his Uncle Boo Boo. Or his Uncle Bobo. Because we told the doctor when we did the ultrasound that we don't want him to tell us anything. We want it to be because there's something special about expecting. Can I get a witness? In our text this morning, Dr. Luke tells us of a woman named Hannah. Let me give you a heads up right away. If you're looking for her, you won't find Anna in any nativity scenes. You won't find her in any Christmas cards you'll be getting. But Anna was there in that first Christmas pageant as one who was expecting not something, but expecting someone whose name is Jesus, the Savior of the whole world. Track with me. Dr. Luke says, every day she'd be in the temple expecting the Messiah. The religious folk, the religious people in the temple probably think she was losing her marbles to be coming to church every Sunday looking for a baby for 84 years. Sister Iceland, 84 years looking for one and only one thing. Just as some naysayers in your life are thinking you're wasting your time coming to church Sunday after Sunday, worshiping a God you can't even see. They mocked her. And yet she kept believing that God is not a man that he should lie, nor the son of man that he should repent, that what God says he will do, and what he does, he has said. Oh, I don't know. Where are all my believers in the house this morning? So because she's heard from God's mouth through the prophets that the Messiah was coming, Dr. Luke said in verse 38 that Anna was looking for the redemption. She was expecting. Is there anybody in here expecting for 2016? I say, is there anyone in here who is looking for redemption off? Redemption off. Oh, this is good. Every day, she'll be scanning through the crowd in the temple, looking for a young couple with a child, and not just an ordinary child, but is looking for one that we sing about. Come, thou expected Jesus, who born to set his people free from our fears and sins, release us. The desire of every nation, the joy of every longing. And she'll be going, Lord, is it this one? Lord, is it this one? Is it this one? Oh Lord. And the Spirit will say, and she'll come back again. I say, Lord, Is it this one? For nearly 84 years, verse 37 says, she was expecting. Oh, somebody missed that. Mom, I know you can wait long. You can. You are from an old generation. Your generation knows what it means to wait. You still have a rotary phone in your house.
I see it. I know.
Kids these days, mom, kids these days don't know what a rotary phone is. You know? They have iTouch. And we touch. And everybody touch. We are the instant generation. We eat instant potato, instant rice, we drink instant coffee, and I'm told you could drink instant tea. God help you, if I come visit your house and you serve me instant tea, you're no more a member of Burma. But the Bible says in verse 38 that finally, in the fullness of time, one day, at the very moment, Lord help me, she came up and began giving thanks to God. Why? Because finally, her eyes had seen the long expected Jesus. But wait a minute, wait a minute, wait a minute, wait a minute. How in the world? I've taught you to be Bible students. Interact with your Bible. Don't just read, but read to get. How in the world did she know that this very baby was the one she's been expecting? Mary and Joseph didn't have a name tags on saying who they were. Even Jesus himself didn't have a golden halo above his head to mark him different from all the hundred of babies that would be presented in the temple that day. What you see here, the golden halo you see above baby Jesus' head here, that's all my cards. That's all marked card for you. Because the Bible says in Isaiah chapter 53 verse 2, for he has no stately form or majesty that we should look. Ah! Meaning, for all we know, the baby Jesus in the Bible was just like an ordinary, ugly looking baby. Ah, see, Hollywood has so glamorized Jesus for you that if I even take you deeper, you go, Pastor, don't mess with our mind. I think all babies are ugly. Sorry for those of you who have little babies here. I think all babies are ugly and all babies look alike. No, think with me. I don't know how you can tell babies apart from each other when they're newly born. You go to the hospital when a baby, they're newly born. Why do you think the hospital put name tags?
Because you can't tell them apart. And you're going, ooh, such a cutie. Liar! Pants on fire! But I'll tell you the secret of how Anna was able to pick baby Jesus out from the crowds of babies that would be in the temple that morning. Are you ready for this? This is an open revelation. The secret is found in Luke chapter 2, verse 37. Luke chapter 2, verse 37. Look at it. And she never left the temple, serving night and day. Watch this. Watch this. Serving night and day with. Watch this, watch this, watch this. Don't hurry me up. With fastings. Some of you are saying fasting. With fastings and what? Prayers. Oh, somebody missed that. Somebody missed that. She was serving night and day with what? I can't hear you, church. What? And good God of heaven. And she was still doing it at age 84. Give me the light point. Sally, you're doing well. If you don't have a church, can you come to Wellman Heights Baptist Church? Keep going. Light point. See, when you serve the Lord with fastings and prayers, He will reveal deep secrets. He will reveal deep things to you. Is anybody in here who know what I'm talking about? This is really why the Lord has given me this message to you this morning. If you are expecting God to do for you in 2016 what only He can do, chances are you know a lot about prayers. But how much of fastings do you know? Oh Lord, it got quiet in here. I told you when I tell them about fastings, they'll go quiet on me. Haven't you heard Jesus say to the disciples in Matthew chapter 17, verse 21, but this kind, talking about this mountain, this kind cannot be moved except by prayer and many of us know what the prayer is. We do the prayer part when our world is closing in on us. We try to pray when the mountain, when the mountain becomes too steep to climb. We do everything we can to pray, Lord, please help me help. Or we call the pastor to say, Pastor, please pray for us. This mountain is too steep. But when it comes to the fastings, our king's stomach starts growling. Because Satan knows if he can keep you from fastings, if he can keep this greatest weapon of spiritual breakthrough called fastings from you as a well-kept secret, Even when Jesus already said to you, this mountain can only be removed. This yoke can only be broken. This tragedy can only be averted by not just prayers, but with fastings. If you can keep that as a secret for you, then he would have succeeded in keeping you down in the valley, depressed and defeated. But how many here know that the devil is a liar and Jesus is still the Messiah? Because somebody here this morning, I don't know who you are. Somebody here this morning, like Anna, you are at that very moment. He said at that very moment. You are at that very moment. Moment. When you will see what you've been expecting. When you see your miracles, your miracle baby you've been believing God for is about to be delivered into your hands in Jesus' name. Somebody shout yes! I don't know. Dickie Neal, I don't know who this message is for. I wasn't even planning on speaking on fastings as a Christmas message. Ha! Until a few weeks ago, before we left for Africa, the deacons and I were at our board meeting praying and praying and praying for the emotional burdens and the healing needs and the relationship burdens and the devotion, the directional challenges that we know that many of you are carrying. And we were praying and praying and praying for you till we didn't even have time for the meeting. Can I get a witness from all the deacons here? And during the meeting, during the prayer time, I stopped the gentleman and I said, guys, the Spirit of God just impressed upon my heart to call the entire church to go on a 21 days of fastings and prayers in the new year. See? He got quiet. I knew you wouldn't be shouting right there. I said, Lord, are you serious? What we normally do around this time of the year, leading to the anointing service, Sister Sherry, is I will tell you to take 3-4 days fasting, preparing for the anointing so you can receive. But never a 21-day fasting. I said, Lord, are you sure? Ego, did you say 2016 you're going to be going deeper with me? I said, yes. Is there any better way to start a new year that you want to go deeper with me than to show me you really need me, that Jesus, you're all I need? And he said, son, you've been praying this long. Doesn't that tell you that the people in your church who are carrying heavy burdens, who have mountains too tall for them to move? And I've already showed you in the word that there are only two means that I would use to move those mountains. Fastings and prayers. All of a sudden, it made sense. Elaine, thank you. church, most of you are familiar with this young girl's story. How the thief who comes to steal, kill, and destroy took her away from us. This girl was once a worship leader in this church, leading us all to worship. Until one afternoon, 6 months ago, she walked in saying, "I've converted to be a Muslim. I don't know about this God you're talking about, but Allah is going to be my God." And we were all dumbfounded. But we went to prayer for her soul. Perplexed but not despairing. Struck down but not destroyed. Before we left for Africa, you go back to the message, and when I was speaking, I stood here before you guys, and the dad was sitting there or whatever, I can't remember where he was sitting, and I stood there declaring in faith and believing that someday a lane will turn back to the Lord, into this church, to give God the glory. Church, listen. I didn't know. I never knew. I will be honest with you. I didn't know. I was believing. I was trusting. But I didn't know I was going to be witnessing. I was going to be witnessing our own at that very moment. Ah! Like Anna, I didn't know we were going to witness our own very moment miracle. Look who is here worshiping with us this morning! Hallelujah! Hey! 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 Lord! Every praise
is to our God.
Every word of worship
with one accord.
Every praise. Elaine, stand up. Everybody sit there, Elaine, stand. If you are sitting here this morning and you're still a skeptic, you're wondering if God is moving and working in the lives of people here at Wellman, and if you're still doubting if revival, my breakthrough prayer concert people are already nodding. If you are still doubting if revival has come into this place, I'll tell you, when you leave this service, you got to go check yourself up. As your pastor, I'm just being candid. Few weeks ago, you were all here when Brother Walters got baptized. Right here. And after his baptism, this is an 80 plus year old man. I just thank God for all our seniors. Because God isn't finished with you guys yet. God wasn't finished with Anna yet. God wasn't finished with Brother Walters yet. Our 80 plus year old man said, "I'm going to get baptized before I see Jesus." And he got baptized a few weeks ago. And the service wasn't over. His two granddaughters, twins, got, you are all here, got up in their street clothes and saying, "We too want to be baptized." Few
few minutes later, a lady, I don't know who she was, I couldn't recognize her. She came up here, bawling, crying, and they were comforting her here. The next thing I know was she got up and she walked toward this way too. She too said she wanted to be baptized. But did you know that that mother who got up was the mother of those two twins, And did you know that she was the daughter of Brother Walters? That on that same day, three generations of people said, we want to see Jesus. And the mother was like, if they're all going, I don't want to be left behind. I too want to be dunked. And she got up. And now we learn. I'm going somewhere. We're saying, Lord, before the year comes to an end, show us your glory. Show us your power. Nothing is too difficult for you to do. You heard all my messages and all my prayer focusing on that young girl. I thought maybe 15 years from now, she'll walk in. No, God said, I'm doing something. God said, I'm doing something at Guelma Heights. What eyes have not seen, what ears have not heard, that which hasn't entered into the hearts of men that are prepared. Is anybody here expecting? Is anybody here expected? You got to come back on New Year's Eve and hear this family testify to you the hell they've been through. I said to the deacons and to the ER team, here are people, you remember, in our fall conference, we were saying, it would be nice to have somebody who can give a testimony of what God, that God is able to do. And everybody said, wouldn't it be a miracle if Elaine came back to God, and she can testify that the Bible said, I will never leave thee. That Jesus said, whomever the Father has given unto me, I will by no means. He said, no one. Somebody said, no one. He said, no one will be able to snatch them away from my hands. We thought it would be, give you 10 years, she'll come back. But just this past week, Elaine said, I'm renouncing Islam because I've seen the light of the world again. Was lost, but now I was blind, but now lift up your hands toward her. I was declaring over her yesterday. Was it yesterday I saw you guys? Or Friday? Friday. And I was saying to the dad, I said, God is going to use this girl so mightily, like a missionary. We already prophesied over her at the meeting, right? When we're doing our year out team, that what a powerful testimony she would have. See, because when you've been to hell and come back, and you know that there's no one like God, you would have a testimony. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, we give you all the glory this morning. Father, that you will receive all the glory and you receive all the praise. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. 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 Whoa! You see why now? When I heard God said a few weeks ago, call my church to a time of 21 days of fastings and prayers. You see why I said, yes, Lord? We will do it, because if God has done all that we've seen so far. Thank you. Joan, give me. Take that home. You received it. You receive it. If God would do all that we've seen this year so far without us going to 21 day fast, what do you think he's getting ready to do when he says this mountain can only be moved through prayer and fastings? It could only mean that God is getting ready to do exceedingly, abundantly, above and beyond what we could ask or think. Is anybody expecting? I said, is anybody expecting? I got to cut this short. I miss you guys. I'm only on page 19 of 36. How am I going to do this? For 15 minutes. Let me quickly give you two impartations. Because I have to teach you this. If you're going to go to it, because in your getting, get understanding. If you're going to go 21 day fast, I have to teach you what you're doing. That's why the Holy Spirit said, even in the Christmas passage, see the connection? I was going to preach on Christmas, some message. And I was saying, okay, Lord, if you want me to speak on fasting, you better give me a Christmas message that is in fasting. Hannah. Let me give you two impartations on fasting, quickly. Because I know you have to hurry home to go cook that curry goat and jerk chicken you'll be bringing for our Welma Christmas around the world dinner this evening. And I too have to go pound my pounded yam and cook my spinach with cow foot and liver that I'm going to be bringing too. What a Sunday to be preaching about fasting. God, I said, God, you have such a great sense of humor. Anyhow, how many of you are ready to receive? Amen. Number one, let's talk about the purpose of fasting. We're going to do this quickly. First, when you talk about the purpose of fasting, we got to talk about what fasting is not. Because if you're going to find out what fasting is and why you fast, you got to talk about what fasting is not. Because a lot of people get confused when we talk about fastings. And that's why you don't hear, especially in Baptist churches, talking about fastings. We don't. The enemy uses it as a well-kept secret for us. But you don't understand the power that is in fasting. So let's talk about what fasting is not. Fasting, number one, is not dieting. If you're merely giving up food, if you're merely giving up food for a period of time, I call that a hunger strike.
You don't fast so you can lose weight either. Hello, somebody. Okay, I'll just skip this joke. I'm going to skip this one so I can get to my point. I was going to tell you about a guy who was on dieting, but let's get that out of the way. So fasting is not dieting. Say fasting is not dieting. Okay. So if fasting is not dieting, what is fasting then, you asked? I'm glad you asked. Put it up, what fasting is? Fasting is the voluntary abstinence from food for spiritual purposes. Let me repeat that. Fasting is the voluntary abstinence from food for spiritual purposes. If you're going on fasting, it's important for you to know that you're doing it. It's important. Well, listen to me very carefully. It's good. Whenever you're going on fasting, it's important for you to know that you're doing it to get God's attention. And not just because you're missing lunch, because you're too busy. When Isaiah said in Isaiah chapter 58 verse 4, give it to me. Isaiah 58 verse 4, when Isaiah said, you do not fast. By the way, over this next 21 days, I'm going to be giving you every Sunday passages for you to be reading on fasting and some prayer points. Isaiah said, you do not fast like you do today to make your voice heard. Where? Where, church? The implication is, fasting is done to make your voice heard on high. In other words, when you're fasting, you're saying no to the flesh so you can say yes to the spirit. It's where you say no to you so you can hear God say yes to you. Ah, that is so good. And I'm wondering, is anybody in here ready to hear yes from God in 2016? Because it comes with the package of expecting. That's how you get your answer when God says yes to you. But you got to be willing to say no to you first. And God ordained it, this is how we did it, that one of the ways that we can deny ourselves for a period, for a moment, is through fastings. Oh, by the way, I got to say this before I give you my lifeline. Go to the lifeline. Let me say this. You're asking, so pastor, how old do I have to be to fast? Some of you are going, oh, pastor, man, I'm too old, I can't fast. You missed it. How old was Anna? So Anna was 84 and she was still fasting. So those of you who are seniors, don't talk to me and say, oh, pastor, you know. And then those of you who are young, oh, pastor, I'm just a teenager. No. If Anna, who is 84 years old, can fast, how young do you have to be to fast? You got my point. Give me the lifeline. So, here's what we need to do. If we're getting ready to say yes to God, especially in 2016 that we're declaring as the year of going deeper with God, let's start the year with a 21-day fastings. Beginning in January the 4th. So see, I give you all the Christmas. We give you all the New Year. And then let's start. Let's go to work. January 4th to the 24th. Because it's not going to be just about talking the talk. is going to be about how bad do you want it? How bad do you want that breakthrough in 2016? You want that mountain to be removed that you've been praying for? How bad do you really want your husband or your wife or that son or child to be saved? How bad do you want it? Talk to your neighbor and ask, how bad do you want it? I mean, look at what we would do to eat when we're hungry. Look at what we would do to eat when we're hungry. Look at the extent some of us will go to fill our stomach. When we are hungry, we make a way where there's no way. I've seen some of you get up in the middle of the night and you make sandwiches out of what is unsandwichable. Come on, tell the truth and put the devil to shame. I see things. I got x-ray eyes. I see some of you in your house. When we are hungry, we stop by, we go out of our way to satisfy King's stomach. Why? Because a hungry person is a desperate person. God says to tell you in Isaiah chapter 58 verse 4 that in the same way when you fast, you're letting your desperation be made known to heaven so that heaven can hear your voice. And you're saying, all I need is you, Lord. All I need is you. You're saying, all I want is you, Lord, because nothing in this world will satisfy. Jesus, you are the cup that won't. Oh, hello, somebody. Now, I have to warn you. Ladies, you've heard the sayings. The way to a man's heart is through his. Right, ladies? I have to warn you. The devil knows that too. That's why he tempted Eve. That's why the devil got Eve to tempt Adam with a pear. Or is it apple? Whatever. But it's not only the devil that will feel uncomfortable when you get fasting. That's what I'm getting at. You will feel uncomfortable because what the devil wants you to do is to satisfy the flesh. That's the first temptation that came to man was what? The apple, the pear. And the first temptation that Jesus Christ faced was what? Food. Food was the first temptation in the garden. Food was the first temptation on the mountain. One fell, the one said no to flesh. The one said yes to flesh, the one showed us the way. Hey! Ooh, this is good. But the point I'm making is, it's not only the devil that will feel uncomfortable when you're fasting. Your stomach will be mad at you too. Some Christians I know could very well be the geographical location of the bottomless pit. Oh, I have pictures, I've seen some of you here in action whenever we're having potlucks at Wema or this, like what we're going to have tonight, and those funerals. The worst thing you can do is to buy a huge bag of your favorite potato chips Lays at the beginning of your fasting. You know how hard to eat just one. Can I get a witness? I bet you can't just eat one. Oh.
Somebody's gonna get it behind me, Satan. Guard this with your life. Those vultures are coming after service. I will assure you right now, that potato chips will be calling out to you. Hello, Joan. How are you? We are here. We are lonely. I can't stop with one. It's not true. But, well, I've been doing all the walking and you've been doing all the sitting, so let me feed myself. I'm going to be going on 21 day fast soon. I can assure you, he'll be calling your name. He'll be saying, but you can't eat just one. Then it'll be too late to start rebuking. You'll be too late to start rebuking that potato chips and start prophesying and claiming authority over it. No. You don't want to be watching TV commercials on the new pan pizza that Pizza Hut just put in the market and they're promoting when you're fasting. So before I give you the second impartation quickly, I have a few more minutes. Let me quickly show you the three types of fasting in the Bible. Is this happening to anybody? Three type of fasting in the Bible, quickly. We've got to do this quickly. The first one is the absolute fasting. You will see that, I don't have time, in Ezra chapter 8 verse 21 and Esther chapter 4 verse 16. That's a fast where you take in nothing. No food, no water. And you only do it for no longer than... And you only do it for no longer than 3 days. 3 days. Ezra was one day. They called the whole congregation to an absolute fast, no water, no drink, one day. The third example, Esther, was 3 days. For medical reason, you can't do it past 3 days. Okay. The second type of fasting is called, and it's found, or it's called the normal fasting. The normal fasting is where you abstain from food, but you can drink a lot of water. That's the type of fasting Jesus did in Luke chapter 4, verse 2. It's interesting. Go read it. It's interesting, Dr. Luke. If you can give us Luke 4, 2 quickly, that would be good. It's interesting. Dr. Luke, who is a physician, said, and he ate, that is Jesus, and he ate nothing. You see that? The implication is, I just discovered this as I was studying. I thought when Jesus fasted, he didn't eat and he didn't drink. But when he said he ate nothing, the implication is he didn't eat anything, but he drank a lot. So this is where you can abstain from food, but you drink a lot of water. It's called a normal fast. The third one in the Bible, quickly, is the type that I hope we can go on. It's the partial fasting that is found in Daniel chapter 10, verse 2 and 3, where Daniel fasted for 21 days without eating meat, without eating sweets, and without drinking wine. Somebody said, I can do that. But the sweet part, and Dickie Neal is saying, the sweet part, my chocolates. And what Daniel was just eating was strictly vegetables, fruits, lentils, and he drank only water.
whenever is breaking is fast. And talking about breaking the fast, you could start from when you go to bed till 6 o'clock in the next evening, not in the morning. I mean, in the morning, so you eat while you're sleeping? Till evening, right? Till evening or till 3 o'clock. And when you break your fast, this is very important. It's important that you don't gorge yourself right away too. Your stomach won't like you. So he said, Dr. Tai, what can I expect if I fast over these 21 days? What can I expect? Here's my second imputation. I'm going to give it to you in 2 minutes and then we're gone. As we close. Number one. Sorry, the second impartation is the privileges. Here's what you can expect. Because you're all expecting. Oh, this is good. Tell two people around you, this is a juicy one is coming. Yeah, a juicy one is coming. It's all here in Isaiah chapter 58. First, you can expect deliverance. Verse 6 of Isaiah 58 says, is this not the fast which I choose to loosen the bonds of wickedness, to undo the bands of the yoke, and to let the oppressed go free? That's deliverance. Somebody said that's deliverance. Is there anyone in here in need of deliverance from an addiction you just can't kick, or a stronghold you just can't break, or you need someone who, or you know someone who is bound and they need to be set free? God's word says to tell you, fast. Fast. Because I know some of you, like Daniel, your soul is in despair and you're about to give up. But God is asking you, have you fasted about that son? Have you fasted about that daughter? Have you fasted about that addiction yet? Because if you haven't fasted for that son or that daughter or that wife, then you haven't done everything. Paul says, haven't done all you can do, stand. If you haven't fasted, God is saying you haven't done all that you can do. There's still one more option, fast. Then you can stand. Throw yourself at his mercy and say, Lord, I need you. I'm desperate for you, Lord. I need you more than these drugs. I need you more than this porn. I need you, oh God, more than... As Job said in Job chapter 23 verse 12, he said, thy word, oh, I desire more than food itself. Who is expecting deliverance this year? I don't know what, I'm expecting miracles. I'm expecting uncommon favor. I'm expecting breakthrough in 2016. Somebody holler, I'm expecting. Here's the second privilege you can expect when you fast, and then we're done. Direction. You get direction. Verse 8 says, then your light will break out like the dawn, and your recovery will speed, daily spring forth. Ooh. Is there anyone in here at a crossroad of a major decision and you don't know what or which way to go? Then be like King Jehoshaphat when the enemy came in running like a flood and he didn't know what to do. He called the people of Judah to fast. And the Bible said the moment they finished fasting, God took away the road block. Oh, maybe I should be testifying. I'll say this quickly. I know the power of fasting in my life. It's the anointing that breaks things. I try, except maybe when I'm on holiday, I try to take a day a week to fast.
But I've never done this before, except once. I've never went on a 21-day fast before, except one time in my life. And I went on this fast. My goodness, I came out looking like one of those starved refugees you see on the TV. And some of you thought I was sick, but I wasn't sick. This church was at the verge of a major crossroad of an important decision we needed to make. And that year, for a whole year, it was over our youth pastor back then as to whether or not we should continue on staff. And for a whole year, 10 months to be specific, the church didn't know what to do. We were floundering. And all hell was breaking loose. Most of you didn't know. And in the middle of that, I've never done this before, I heard the Lord said, "Son, go on a 21-day fast." Never know what that means. So I studied. I thought I was going to die. I started in the middle of October. It went into November. And just when I finished that 21-day fast. Would you know that at our annual general meeting in November of that month, just as I finished, the church made a decision they couldn't have made all this time. And God showed up and saved Wilma from a disaster, from something that could have destroyed this church. You would not have been here. Because the Bible said, "I will let light to break out. I will let light break out like dawn, and your recovery will speed forth." I don't know who I'm speaking to this morning. Somebody here, you have been bound, and I've come to prophesy over you that your recovery, you've been crying, you've been fasting, you've been praying, but this morning, like Anna, I came to declare over you that your recovery is about to spring forth speedily. In Jesus' name, shout amen. Because weeping may endure for the night, but a shout of joy. David, what did you say? A shout of joy comes in there. If you can feel your strength coming to you right now, stand up on your feet. I'm done. Welcome back. I trust that message was a blessing to you. What a wonderful day in the house of the Lord this morning, as you see the awesome work of God that is doing here at Wilma. Heaven came down and glory filled our soul. What a wonderful day to be alive, to see God doing awesome things, to see God restoring, and to see God breaking yokes and delivering people. You heard the testimony of that young lady who was a vibrant believer and strolled away to be converted into a Muslim, to Islam, and she came back again, praising God, renouncing Islam, and saying, "I've seen the light again, the light of the world, the one and only Jesus whom we're serving and who is the reason for this season." And this morning we were speaking about expecting. I don't know what you're expecting. I don't know what you're expecting God to do for you as we go into 2016. But 2016, we're declaring as a year of going deeper in God. And one of the things that God has laid in the scripture, as we've seen this morning, to draw us closer to Him is those two powerful spiritual disciplines called fastings and prayers. I know you know a little bit about prayer, but when it comes to fastings, we get nervous. But this morning we're able to shed some light on what God wants us to do and how we can call out to God and how we can get God's attention through fasting so that our
voices could be heard on high. I hope that message was a blessing to you. Why don't I pray with you right now that God would make your light break forth like the dawn and your healing a speedy springing forth like a speedy recovery, as he did for Anna, so that you too can go out and tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. Why don't I pray with you? Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, I thank you for that person who is watching this broadcast right now, whether they're at a crossroad of a major decision. Father, that through the power of fasting, you will give them a new revelation. You will shed light onto their path. And Father, whether they're looking for deliverance, you said fasting can break yokes. Father, I pray in the mighty name of Jesus that as they go with you in this fasting, that you will lose the bonds in their life, lose the bond in their husband, lose the bonds in that wife, lose the bond in that son, lose the bond in that daughter. Father, that you will receive all the glory. You've done it once, we know you can do it again, and we'll give you all the praise. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Amen. Listen, God is calling us here at Wellman Heights Baptist Church to a 21-day fasting beginning January the 4th to 24th. Oh, 2016 is going to be a year like never before, but we want to start it right with God. Why don't you join us? Join us in this fasting season, and we're expecting God to show up so that our voice can be heard on high. We love you. We believe in God's best for you as you go into the new year, that he will help you finish this year strong and catapult you to a brand prosperous new year. We love you and we look forward to seeing you again next week as we continue on the Lord. Have a blessed week. In Jesus' name, amen.